In part one of our lesson on sum and difference identities for sine and tangent, we will derive and use the sum and difference identities for sine. To derive the sum identity for sine, we're going to start off using a cofunction identity. Recall that sine of theta is equal to the cosine of pi over 2 minus theta. Applying this cofunction identity to sine of a plus b means we can write it as the cosine of pi over 2 minus a plus b. Because remember, the sine of anything is equal to cosine of pi over 2 minus the anything. So if my anything is a plus b, then sine of a plus b will be cosine of pi over 2 minus a plus b. We can distribute that minus sign inside the argument. We will get cosine of pi over 2 minus a minus b, which equals cosine of pi over 2 minus a, and we're going to put that in parentheses, minus b. So all we used was the associative property here to say that it's okay to take this expression and put parentheses around the first two terms. Now we are going to apply the difference identity for cosine. So if we had cosine of, let's say, x minus y, we know that would be cosine x cosine y plus sine of x sine of y. Now, if we apply that to this expression, where pi over 2 minus a is acting like x and the b is acting like y, or another way to think of this is cosine of the first, cosine of the second, plus sine of the first, sine of the second, then this expression turns into cosine of the first, which is pi over 2 minus a, times cosine of the second, cosine b, plus sine of the first, so sine of pi over 2 minus a, times sine of the second, b. Now we can use a cofunction identity. We know that the cosine of pi over 2 minus a is equal to the sine of a. We're going to take this cosine of b and bring it directly down. Plus, we've got sine of pi over 2 minus a, which we can replace using the cofunction identity and call it cosine of a, and then the sine of b comes right down. And this is what's called the sum identity for sine. Now, to derive the difference identity for sine, we're going to make use of the sum identity for sine that we just derived. We can rewrite sine of a minus b as sine of a plus a negative b. Now, applying the sum identity for sine, we know we have to take sine of the first, so that would be sine of A, times cosine of the second, and in this case, the second is negative B. Then we have to add to that the cosine of the first, so cosine A, times sine of the second, sine negative B. Now we can use our negative angle identities. Let's remind ourselves that cosine of negative theta is equal to cosine theta, and that happens because cosine is even. So this first term is going to become sine of A times the cosine of B. Then we have that plus sign. We can bring down the cosine of A. And now let's review the negative angle identity for sine. We know that sine of negative theta is equal to negative sine theta because sine is odd. So that means sine of negative B is going to be replaced with negative sine B. And when we simplify this, we are going to get sine of A times the cosine of B. Then because of this minus sign right here, this will turn into minus cosine of A times the sine of B. We can bring down that sine A minus B. So this is what's known as the difference identity for sine. In this example, we have to find the exact value of the sine of 15 degrees. Now, we know that we can write 15 degrees as the difference of 45 degrees and 30 degrees, and then we can apply the trig identity we just learned, that sine of A minus B is going to equal sine of A cosine B minus cosine A sine B. Then sine of 15 is going to become sine of 45 degrees times the cosine of 30 degrees minus the cosine of 45 degrees times the sine of 30 degrees. Now all we have to do is fill in each trig function value. We know that the sine of 45 degrees is radical 2 over 2. The cosine of 30 is radical 3 over 2 minus cosine of 45 is radical 2 over 2. And the sine of 30 is 1/2. We can see we have a denominator of 4 here and a denominator of 4 here, so we already have a common denominator of 4. This product will be radical 2 times radical 3, which is radical 6, and we have to subtract this product, radical 2 times 1, which is radical 2. And just a quick reminder, radical 6 and radical 2 are not like terms. They cannot be combined, so this answer is in simplest form. In this example, we have to find the exact value of sine of 7 pi over 12. Now that's not one of our special angles, so we can start writing down the special angles and combine them to get 7 pi over 12. We know we have pi over 6, which would be 2 pi over 12, pi over 4 would be 3 pi over 12, pi over 3 would be 4 pi over 12, and we can see that 3 pi over 12 plus 4 pi over 12 is going to combine together to be 7 pi over 12. Now we can write sine of 7 pi over 12 as the sine of, we said 3 pi over 12 plus 4 pi over 12, but we will want to use the reduced forms because those are easier for us to remember the trig values for. So it's going to be pi over 4 plus pi over 3. Let's write down our identity. We know we're doing sine of a plus b, so that's going to be sine of a cosine b plus cosine of a times the sine of b. So our sine of 7 pi over 12 is going to turn into sine of pi over 4 times the cosine of pi over 3 plus the cosine of pi over 4 times the sine of pi over 3. Now our job is to fill in the trig function values. The sine of pi over 4 is radical 2 over 2. Cosine of pi over 3 is 1/2 plus, we've got the cosine of pi over 4, which is radical 2 over 2, and the sine of pi over 3, which is radical 3 over 2. This first product has a denominator of 4, and so does the second. So we've got our common denominator already. Radical 2 times 1 is radical 2 plus radical 2 times 3 is radical 6. And you'll notice that a lot of these answers are very similar. They're just different by plus or minus signs. And that's going to happen a lot because we're using the trig function values for the special angles. So it's going to be combinations of radical 2 over 2 times 1 over 2 or radical 2 over 2 times 3 over 2. So many of your answers will look like this. In this example, we have to simplify the sine of pi minus theta. So this is an application of the difference identity for sine. So we have sine of a minus b is going to be sine of a times the cosine of b minus the cosine of a times the sine of b. If you can convince yourself to write down the identity every time before you use it, then really you're going to memorize that identity for free, I call it. Because writing it down over and over again as you do your homework, then you won't have to stay up all night the night before the exam memorizing identities, because you'll have written it down so many times, you'll have memorized it for free. Applying the difference identity for sine to the expression sine of pi minus theta, we see we're going to get sine of pi times the cosine of theta minus cosine of pi times the sine of theta. Now we can fill in the value for sine of pi. We know it is 0, and that's multiplying the cosine of theta. Bring down the minus sign. Now cosine of pi we know is negative 1, and we multiply that times sine of theta. When we simplify this, we get sine of theta. So it turns out that the sine of pi minus theta equals sine of theta. Now, if you think about this physically, what's happening? Suppose we have an angle in here, theta, and we know that pi is right here. So if we consider the angle pi minus theta, then that means we would start at pi, we would back up by theta, which would mean we are here at pi minus theta. Now remember that sine is the y value. Think of this on the unit circle, and we can see that the y value of this point is the same as the y value of the other point. So the sine of theta is the same as the sine of pi minus theta. And it's good to think about that physical relationship that's happening.